Good evening and welcome to you all. This evening we will have the pleasure of hearing from one of Russia's leading voices in the fields of finance and economics and education, Ruben Vardanyan. Ruben is here to argue that not only that Russia can host the World Olympics, the Winter Olympics, successfully, but also, and much more terrifyingly, that Russia and a host of other emerging economies can also create, develop, and institutionalize professional schools of the highest quality. To introduce him, I will introduce to you the Dean of SIPA, Merit Janow, who to this audience needs no introduction whatsoever. Dean Janow has served brilliantly as Dean of SIPA since July 2013 and has been on our faculty since 1994. For the past 18 years, she has been Professor of Law and Professor at SIPA, and previous to that was Director of the International Finance and Economic Policy Concentration here at the school. Dean Janow is a leading expert on international trade and investment with a specialization in East Asia. She has had, or endured, perhaps is the better word, three periods of public service as senior negotiator with Japan and China for the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative, as executive director on international antitrust law and policy for the Attorney General of the United States and the Department of Justice, and as a North American judge on the appellate body of the World Trade Organization. It's a pleasure to introduce to you someone who needs no introduction to this audience, Dean Merit Janow.
Thank you very much. It's really delighted to see so many of you here. We're here to hear from Ruben Vardanyan, so I won't have a long introduction except to say how happy that we are that you are here, and Veronica Vardanyan as well. Thank you for spending time with us. You are very famous as a leading figure in economics and finance, but also a leading proponent of higher education. And so I know you will speak to that tonight. But for those who don't know all of his history, let me just mention a few high points of relevance to tonight's discussion. Of course, he's now an advisor to the chairman of the board and CEO of Sberbank of Russia, but prior to the merger of that institution in 2012, he served as CEO chairman of the board at Troika Dialogue, one of the oldest and largest investment banks in Russia and the CIS. And he is a member of the Economic Advisory Board at the IFC, the private sector arm of the World Bank group, and a board member of several companies. And he's also a founding partner of SKOLKOVO, Moscow School of Management, and vice chairman of the International Advisory Board. He oversees the school's Institute for Emerging Market Studies and Wealth Management and Philanthropy Center, and is a member of the President's Council for Priority Projects and the International Advisory Boards of several educational institutions, the International Christian University in Japan, which is an outstanding school I know very well, the Guanghou School of Management in China, and the FDC in Brazil. So he has really a global perspective around education. He's a graduate from Moscow State University. He also studied at INSEAD, Harvard Business School, Yale University, and Stanford. So there's one school obviously missing here, but it's not too late. So this evening, Mr. Vardanyan has agreed to speak with us on the topic of key challenges of the 21st century, people and education. Can emerging markets have leading professional schools? After his remarks, Professor Jan Svejnar, who is the director of the Center for Global Economic Governance and a leading economist, will ask a few questions, as will I, and then we'll open it up to you for your questions. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Vardanyan. Thank you.
Thank Good evening, everybody. I'm really glad to be here, and thank you for this generous introduction. I know it's not easy in the first day evening, spending time here, not going to much more interesting places to be. I'm sure is a big challenge to choose between coming and hearing somebody from Russia talking about education. But I will try to, in my short introduction speech, say a little bit about my vision and my key points, which I will try to deliver to you and hope to have an open and friendly discussion. But before I will start, I want to ask you, just from my audience, how many of you never been in Russia? How many of you? Okay, it's majority. Good, okay, just being understanding with kind of the... Because one of the points, of course, of today's conversation is also about perception and reality, because we're all living in a world which is becoming multicultural, multi-integrated. At the same time, we're continuing living with a lot of myths and perceptions. And what is reality? What's the myths? I think is one of the key points of education to change and to destroy some of the wrong perceptions and wrong myths. I want to start from my main message is that I believe we are living in a new stage of development of the world. If you look at the 19th century, before 19th century, all the wars was going about the land. People tried to find more territory, they tried to expand their territory, control more. In 20th century, it added by industrial war, just getting more industrial assets, more natural resources. And we've been living in an industrial society, post-industrial society, and now we've come to the stage where we're living in information society. What it means from point of the economical development and development of the countries? It's, in my opinion, and I'm not a professional scientist, but I believe it's that people become main assets because people is getting opportunity to really transform this information which become available, and this is the second big changes that's happening in the world, that information which before was concentrated in some very small group of people who really control this information. It was religion people or it was universities, but it's always been in libraries which people rarely can be allowed to enter or by special permission. Now we can get the information in New York library the same how you can access the people who are sitting in Qatar or Nigeria or Russia. And it's changed an entire situation about, first, the people become very critical assets because really they are creating new assets, new values. Information become available, and we are living in a world that's becoming much more integrated. Today, 20 years ago, 25 years ago, going to China, going to Russia or USSR was not possible for most of the people. There was I came here 2 days ago in Boston, flying from Moscow. I'm flying back tomorrow to London. We're becoming much more integrated. In one hand, we have a chance to live in a world where we really can learn from each other. On the other hand, we continue living in old barriers and old stereotype of mentality. One of the questions I want to ask before going to the next, how many nationalities live in Russia? Any guess? 138. Okay, it's good to, again, people, but I'm sure most of you never thought about this, in Russia 138 nationalities, and how many Muslim, what's the percentage of Muslim population in Russia? It's 15%. Okay, you're getting regions of the different mentality, different behavior, different attitude. We have a Buddhist, we have around 1% Buddhist people living in a special region in Tuva. Again, it's a, when you think Russia, you're always coming to some of the understanding what is Russia is for all of us, it's some stereotype. It's a big territory, cold, vodka, I know, mafia, KGB, whatever. I can go from normal stereotypes sentence we can talk about Russia. And 10 years ago, I was running investment bank, and I said, okay, if Ruben, you're right, and people is main assets, and education is becoming critical for success of the future because information is available, but how to convert this information to the knowledge and how to create a product is becoming very challenging because, yes, information become available for everybody, but it's like person staying in a waterfall. Not everybody can know how to drink this information and how to use this information. And most of the people not using this opportunity or they don't know how to work with this information. And okay, if the people main assets, what will be the future of the any emerging market countries? Before, it was very clear. Everybody, and I'm sure in this room, many people came here from many different countries. It was ideal situation to come to the United States or Western Europe to educate and stay in a country to work and to become successful. But the last 20 years bring some transformation and opportunities for people to go back to their own countries. And in 2004, I said, okay, let's try to see what's going on in the world on business education. I will talk more about business education, not so much about general education. And I went myself, visited 43 business schools worldwide. It was a very interesting exercise because my trip was really, really tough. I was in 1 week, Shanghai, Bangkok, Singapore, Hyderabad, Dubai, Frankfurt, Ljubljana, back to Moscow, and it was in December. It was interesting to be really worldwide traveling to see the difference. At the same time, finding very interesting similarity. The key point that I found was first, we all study about how to make business in developed countries, but in emerging markets, the reality is different. And this is how we can transfer your knowledge from learning something in another place, like in New York or in Boston and Harvard, where you are living in a different environment and you don't understand what's going on in the countries like Russia or China. The second, I realized the opportunity to make money became really interesting to not probably only for the Russians or for the Chinese to make money in their own country, but for many foreigners to come and stay in countries like Russia and to be successful. And this is true. I can go you examples which people really, I'm sure, don't know here, but there's a lot of people who came from other countries and become very successful in Russia and make a lot of money, building some factories and some companies. Anyway, coming back to the point of the education, I realized also the business schools, I mean, before, mostly oriented to the point of the providing case study about how to do some right or wrong things around some stories. But writing case study in emerging markets is very difficult because you don't know enough insights, it's not enough public information, and how you can really provide a full story if you don't living in this country. When I visited these 43 schools, it was also very clear with the business schools becoming more managerial school, not business school, because what we needed is entrepreneurs. And entrepreneurs don't like to go to school. We know all now in the numbers. Today's from Fortune 500, it's only 20% or around this having MBAs. Most of them CEOs doesn't have MBAs or don't have MBAs from the great schools. Whereas you're going minus one level, you're getting 80% people have MBAs of the top. And this is by showing what most of the school preparing people for being good managers, but not very good entrepreneurs. And the question why? What was the problem? Where is the issue with the schools not answering? And in my personal opinion, one of the points, of course, who is going to the school? People going to school, they want to hedge with downside protection. They don't want to take the risk because they want to get the diploma confirming they have some knowledge and want to be sure that they at least will get some minimum compensation. If people want to take a risk, they don't want to waste their time and want to start their businesses without going to school. And because we are unusual, we are not very GMAT, we cannot pass GMAT, we cannot go by typical traditional knowledge-based route. We want to do something different. And I think the internet boom creates this opportunity for people to become successful without going to schools, which also creates some pressure for education. It's why we started our school saying, okay, we want to build international school, which will be looking what's going on worldwide, and we have a big, very close connections with the U.S. schools, with the Latin American schools, with the Chinese schools. But we want to go more by project-based, where people learn doing, not by listening or learning from the other stories. And we also realize that we want to build a school which will be more entrepreneurial, which people will be valued, not by how they pass exams, because in the business school, that we don't believe the passing exams is a key criteria of success. And we're trying to push people in the direction saying, your key criteria of success will be how many times you've been offered by your colleagues partnership idea, or how many times you've been offered to get some money, or how many times you've been offered a job during your education. And because our school was founded by founding members, it's 18 business people, Russian and non-Russian, we said, okay, but from entering, we'll allow to enter the school only people who will be interviewed by founding members. And if the founding member said no, it's no. It doesn't matter how GMAT or how well your, how good your English. It's a very unusual system for the school. But this is what I believe is becoming more and more important for the new realities. You need to choose people not by formal criteria, but also informal criteria, which request a lot of subjectivity. And in doing this all, we want to make some very simple thing. We want to attract people who are usually not going to the schools. We want to attract people who won't see themselves futures to just become managers, but people who really want to change the world. Because key point, which I started, that people main assets, again, it's, we can argue about percentage, but historically it was showing that only 3% or 5% people really transformed the country, transformed the industry, transformed the world. And this is the people who are very active, they're very patient, they're very different. And to attract these people to study, to build a professional school, really became good for them, needs to be something different. We're facing reality with the education, which was before was the leading industry because of the it was more innovative knowledge base, and the people who stay in universities being most respected and most knowledge-based people. Facing some new challenges, because of this information society, we are more reacting what's going around us, not we are not leading. And this is one of the other points which we realize we need to change, and we need to try how we connect the education with the real world around us. That's why the project-based education, we said, will be very critical for the success of the new business schools. The other point I want to mention about the career placement is that true also one of the points of the schools, and this is unfortunately because of the ratings, the key criteria of success of the school was always determined how much salary people will be paid after graduation of the school. And again, getting schools and getting something, new startup, you really need to take your risk, and sometimes you sacrifice your salary. You sacrifice yourself because you want to do something for the future. When I started my business 22 years ago, I was working for a bank, and I was paid a good amount of money. It was $1,000 in 1991. It was a huge salary. But I left this bank and I went to this startup, which was only $35,000 startup capital, and my salary was $100 per month. And I said, I want to take a risk because I want to do things for the future. And this type of decision usually not supported by schools. That's why I said, okay, we need to change attitude who we enter, who is entering the school. We should change the system of education because of the process of the, in emerging markets especially, the failing is one of the key elements of the education which we cannot teach today in the schools, because the case study, for example, is 90% about success, not about the failing. Because failing, telling about the failing is very difficult and not easy to write. And the third, we need to do career placement differently. Today in our school, 52% graduates are their own businesses. Which is just for understanding, in Stanford is 10% and in Seattle or any other school is 5%. This is normal percentage, which is good. And then it's changed because after they're working some consultants, investment banking, of course, they're doing some their own businesses. But most of the people continue to stay in corporate world. They're not going to the, unfortunately, to the this risky, challenging environment to build something their own. This is why, in my opinion, we are in a stage where education will be transformed. Because we are globalization, the opportunity to make money is changed. Because of the information society, you don't need to be educated the traditional way. You can become successful without education, classical, which is questioning what needs to be changed to continue to be successful in the education industry. Education industry will become also much more global. Today you can hire a professor. We have in our school 138 professors coming from all over the world, and we compete with Qatar University or other universities who can hire the same professors. It's not any more exclusive. I told library is becoming available. And the question, what kind of thing needs to you build? What do people really want to come educate in your place? What kind of information, what kind of service, what kind of knowledge, and what kind of the people need to be able to be sure what this will be most of the interesting place or the best town that people will come and not only educate but also stay. And the last point I want to make before start to answer your question is about how we compete for the people. Today, I am Armenian by origin. I was born in Armenia. I made my career in Moscow, in Russia. My family now live in London. I'm traveling all around the world, and I'm a global citizen. And if you look at this, 3-5% people really change the world, changing industry. For them, is a key criteria of the where we're staying is, I believe, four. It's first, where I can achieve most of my success of my career. Second, how secure my family will feel in this environment. Third, what kind of education my kids will get and what kind of healthcare system I can get from the environment which I will live. And I will say it's an interesting story because more and more people traveling back to countries like in Europe. Today is we did a survey with some of the schools with the most young people don't believe they can be successful in Europe. They don't believe they can be really open their new companies and become new entrepreneurs who start companies which will become huge. And this is very dangerous signal for Europe because it's showing with people who will be needs to be next Bill Gates or I know Carlos Ghosn or whatever name. They not believe that the future can be linked to the country. This is why today London is the second biggest city with French-speaking people. They left France because of tax, but also because they don't believe a future can be in France so successful. And I say it's showing some big trends with migration of the people. It's why today we are all facing the challenge about saying, okay, people don't like, if our main assets, we don't like way how we manage them before when it was industrial system, because we want needs to be managed differently, we need to educate them differently, we need to provide a different attractiveness to stay in the country, not by only government, but also by many other elements of the society. And without this, we cannot be competitive. This is why when we're talking about education and the 21st century and the professional schools, I believe it's a huge issue not only for business schools but many schools. What kind of thing you need to change because of this new reality? And this new reality is becoming, you cannot avoid it. You cannot say, oh, we ignore it, we continue to do whatever we did many years before. Because yes, we have some classical approaches, we have some classical elements which needs to be kept forever, but reality around us is absolutely different. Is education become product? Unfortunately, let's be honest, it's 100 years ago, most of the people was not educated. We didn't know how to read, and most of the societies was not. We didn't have a primary school, it's not about high school, university. Today's university become more and more like commodity. This is one with dangerous element, and a good element and bad element for the future of the our societies. But how to be proactive and how to be really successful in the environment with really, really changing around you, with the keeping your traditions, keeping yourself, because education is very conservative by nature. Education is a very conservative industry, and it cannot be changed very easily. It becomes a very good question for discussion, and I don't know all the answers. I'm sure we're doing a lot of mistakes, and we're doing a lot of challenging lot of questions ourselves, and we continue facing a lot of issues which we don't know how to answer. But what I think, I believe, it's very critical to worldwide understand that this is the key area of the transformation and key area of competition and key area of the things which you need to try to find the solutions for next generation, which will become different. We will become more visualization, we become people who are less reading books, more looking at the videos, and we're looking more at the pictures. We don't, people who can travel all around the world and without feeling any abandonment, any restrictions, and people who are really more open for many new things, and we don't understand what the some of the classical things why we need to follow. This is why being investment banker and being the guy who built this business myself from zero, and I didn't graduate any schools, by the way, I graduated Moscow University, and I went to Harvard and INSEAD and many other schools when I already been quite successful top manager, just because I believe it's education. I believe every 2 years I'm trying to go to some school and spend 2-3 weeks just learn what's going in the world, what's going in the key trends. I believe education in the future will be one of the biggest industry. By the way, I don't know if you know it or not, but today is by revenue, the education industry biggest, bigger compared to the oil industry. People are not realizing it because it's very fragmented, it's very not consolidated. But this consolidation is happening, and I know some private groups are consolidating education institutions worldwide trying to build some of the commercialization of education. It's also one of the key question of discussion about how far education can be commercialized and how much it can be really become more profit-oriented institution. I'm sorry I'm not giving you most of the answers, I'm giving more questions, but this is why I'm so glad to be here. I'm sure it will provoke some discussion, some questions from your side, but I'm very glad that we have an opportunity to have a discussion. I'm very glad to be here from Russia, the country which you're not like country where you have a business education. And the first time I said I want to build a business school in Russia, many people look at me and say, it's not possible, you're crazy, it's not, it will not be successful because, and this is one of the things you will never be succeeded. But I like change the perception, I like change the people's mind, but it's not possible. And I like to show that everything is possible if you believe in your vision and you have a real belief of what you're doing. And I also will be very glad to answer any questions about what's going on in Russia, because I believe one of the things which we're trying to achieve during by education is being bringing people together and teaching what's going on in the countries, showing the insights. So I will stop here because I'm sure it's a lot of points I've ever mentioned. People will disagree with me, which I'm glad to argue and find some discussions opportunity with all of you. Thank you.
And I'll allow Professor Svejnar to ask the first question.
All right. Well, there are many questions that come to mind. I should mention, for the sake of full disclosure, I was at the University of Michigan at the business school, Ross School, where I had part of my appointment when SKOLKOVO was being conceived. So some of your people did come and talk to us, so you're absolutely right. You did a terrific background check on what was happening. And it's intriguing to see that, you know, we always knew that Russia had top mathematicians, top physicists, and so there was not to be underestimated. But obviously we were wondering whether a business school, professional school, as such, whether you could actually accomplish it. So congratulations, it's impressive. What also is interesting and intriguing is you're mentioning that you've actually innovated in a major way by stressing the real world success, both in terms of selection of people and in terms of what you are doing. In some sense, the American professional schools are moving in that direction. If you look at the business schools now and 20, 30 years ago, they are stressing much more this applied part. So I think that the first question that naturally comes to mind is, I know school is still young and so on, but are you finding that really the students whom you select more on these entrepreneurial criteria, and then you put them through your school, that they do tend to be more successful afterwards, or is it too early to tell?
It's too early to say, but they're definitely more unusual people, I say. And this is one of the risks you're taking, because when you're choosing the leaders, they are not always standard, right? And this is why we already have some people who failed dramatically, and this is one of the things we need to be ready, because everybody cannot be successful. But we got already very interesting stories. People, for example, two of our graduates started business in China and Hong Kong and become very successful. And this is one Russian, one non-Russian person went into China. And again, it's showing that this is what you don't expect from Russians will go to China and start the businesses outside of Russia. No, we see the trend, it's people more risk takers. This is one of the points, again, that I want to mention, is especially in emerging markets, it needs to be risk taking mood, which is not easy. Especially in countries where failing is not very supported, like in Russia also, because failing is one of the culture we need to teach, but it's not the bad, it's a good thing. And of course, the Silicon Valley is one of the big advantages, but people don't scare to be failing, whereas most of the other institutions, we are feeling always bad when you fail. And in emerging markets, you need to be ready for failing, because it's a much more dynamic environment, much more in transition is why one of the points how you can help people to feel not bad but they are failing is a big question, for especially in emerging markets.
Thank you. Let me ask one question before opening it up. I think you mentioned that you had something like 138 faculty from around the world, and of course you've also been involved in secondary education in with the very international student body and professorial community. My perspective is that faculty, you know, will only stay somewhere for a certain amount of time based on compensation. You know, it doesn't hold faculty past a certain point. And so it has to be an intellectual environment that will capture their attention over time and a community. And I just wonder how you think about keeping that faculty from around the world. What holds them together?
Yeah, let's be clear. It's from 138. Most of them is visiting professors. They not fully stay full job yet in the school. Don't need so big number, but they all coming and study and teaching and doing the special programs. Again, we try to change a lot. I'm sorry, it's, what I will say maybe will sounds very strange from point what we're doing, but we don't have a 10-year system. For example, I don't believe in business school. But again, it's very special about business school, but. Look, the business school, which was established later by other universities, try to be more academical. They try to be close to academical world. They try to show we're the same like any other academical institutions. This is why 10-year system in business school, we don't believe. We like IMD model, where it's not a 10-year system. We like that we have more bonus or type of the motivation, long-term motivation, which more linked to the what you're doing, how you're teaching, and what is the, your real KPIs. It's because I was amazed when I found that 95% of schools is loss maker. Okay, we're teaching about business, and most of business school loss makers. Corporate governance in business school and other schools not clear at all, and who is doing what decision is nobody can explain normally when you're trying to do about corporate governance. So why we are teaching like truth maker without truth, which is normal in any places. But today's demand is different. It's why in getting theory and the practical environment. So different. You don't have one model of success anymore. It needs to be much more multi-modal and find this information and really absorb and transfer to the knowledge. It requires different type of skills, and this is a question how will we react, I don't know yet, but we're trying to find this balance between the not going by training center, become the training center, just train people to do something, but not going theoretical, and this balance between the knowledge transformation, but also practical experience and learning by doing. Where is the line? I don't know yet. It's too early to say, to be honest.
Well, thank you very much. Obviously you're stressing the performance factor for these faculty to keep them there and keep them engaged. Why don't we open it up? And thank you very much, sir. Could you identify yourself and please?
Yes. I'll be quick. I'll be short.
Everyone who asks a question, end with a question.
Absolutely. Alexander Gevorkin, I'm a professor of economics at St. John's University here, but I've taught at Columbia previously, and it's a pleasure to having you, and you're one of your fans. You mentioned several points that I totally agree with, and I'd like to hear a little bit on that. One was you started with perception versus reality, then you stated education being conservative, and then you stated education becoming the biggest industry in the world. On the perception and reality, getting papers published about Russia and Russian business, you get reviews that people are asking, how do you find anything positive in there? That's an issue. But more closer to education, in the emerging markets context, Russia, for example, or any of the Eastern European economies, what is the role of the state compared to the role of, and how it goes in balance with private business? Because it may be that maybe in terms of perception and reality, it may be a sincere effort to help support the school, but it may be misinterpreted as you influencing what goes on in the school. So your thoughts.
You ask many questions.
I know. You raised a lot of questions.
Yeah. Okay, I will try to go quick because I hope I want to give the people a chance to ask more questions, but I think you touched some key points. For example, about reality perception. And also the role of the state in this all what's going in emerging markets. I believe, I'm a strong believer about the people as main assets and people who have a freedom now to travel, you cannot keep people if they don't like to stay. That's why the state role becoming very dangerous, very difficult, because they used to convince what they state is best to people who is really talented to stay in the Today in Russia, and I will want to bring some numbers, unfortunately for a country like what I really like and I hope will be successful for worldwide, from 10 graduates of university, 8 want to work for government. Okay? And this is the statistic showing would continue people scared to go in the private sector because they believe, not because they're going to do corruption, not because of it, but because they have a more prestige, more predictable, more clear, more respected in society position working for government. How you change this attitude? Only by bringing some success stories and showing this is possible. And it's takes time because the big build the good success stories takes much longer compared to making the quick money. This is why we are living in countries like Russia, which are under transition, and we always hear a story about oil and gas, but we don't hear a story about the guy from not from Moscow, from Krasnodar. He built a retail network which is worth now $30 billion, and this is a company that started from zero, and he built beat now Walmart by these ratios, okay? And this is the guy who came from nowhere, and he's a no government connection, and he's not any government support, he's no natural resources, and this is a guy who lives in Russia. Today his efficiency better compared to Walmart, okay? Who knows here from this story? I'm sure you don't heard about it. Okay, one of you. Okay, I'm glad to at least a couple of people who've been living in Russia and heard about him, but most of people don't know about him in the United States. And this is now the story inside of Russia. Really, he's a top hero. But a reality perception, I think, one of the key problems of them inside of society and outside is really one of the points which I always believe is very important for fight against it and try to bring more colorful picture about what's going in the country. I know, I'm sure you don't realize, but most of the foreign companies making more margin, more profit in Russia compared to China. If you look and go any foreign companies today and ask what is the most higher margin in Russia or in China, they'll say in Russia. The size of the market smaller. The most difficult part of from foreign companies, which I helped to invest in Russia, many of them, is unpredictability. You say we are much more profitable, but we can do everything normal 5 years without any problems, and one day we'll face some challenge and some problems which you didn't expect because you didn't violate and we did this all last 5 years. But it's showing again that the profitability can be very high, but unpredictability can be very low and creating some problems. And so I, coming back to the question about the education also, what is the conservative and not? Education must be conservative because it's going thousands of years. We are the one of the key industries. But at the same time, education is becoming, like I said, commodity on one hand, becoming available for everybody. In other hand, you lost the respect for the professor or the teacher. Before in society, being going into any society, the teacher, the doctor, and policeman was in the most respect in the villages. Not anymore, okay? You're not getting this type of the same respect in society about the teaching. That's why you're getting, today's statistic is horrible. From 10 best students graduating university in the United States, only 2.5 want to go to become teacher. In Finland is 8, and in Russia 1 of 30. It's showing that your best people don't want to become teacher. You're getting into trouble. It could be really who will be teach the next generation? Again, I'm not going to go into many other points about this, but definitely it's a big challenge that we are facing.
Let me collect a couple of questions.
Yeah, maybe it'll be,
so otherwise. That you have hear a bit about what's on minds. May I invite you to start us off, please?
Okay.
And I'll collect three, if I may.
Ruben, I had a chance to work on a project that was carried out with your support with Marcus Duhanci. It was a graduate course here at Columbia Graduate School of Architecture about leading student thesis projects, doing a project about Diligent, where Ruben led the development of a school. So my question is about culture. I view that building of the school and building of educational institution as a cultural intervention, large scale, which requires to be able to measure time in cultural centuries rather than political decades. So I wonder, how do you go about evaluating environments in which such interventions are possible? And what are the things that business people need to see in order to go and do project like that?
Thank you. Let me collect two more, please. Sir, lady in the... Yes?
Hello, thank you. My name is Ashkan Kazarian. I am a PhD candidate from Yale and Moscow State University. So my question is about your opinion on latest educational reforms which happened in Russia. And do you see them as a positive thing or as a negative? And because, well, speaking from a place of experience, on Moscow State, the reforms reflected very negatively. And, well, how did they affect the more like new and more like closed up school, business school? Thank you.
And one last one in the front for this round.
I think it's just not the Moscow business people and also graduate from here. My question was, can you tell a little bit about this sort of tough environment from Moscow? What do you think of the bad things and good things happening there? And how is our school will help to develop this sort of environment in Russia?
Like I said, I like to destroy the perceptions by leading by example. When I started my business, I was 22 years old, investment banker, Armenian guy who never worked in Wall Street, and we got $35,000. And people said, "There's no chance you can build a successful investment bank, and people will trust you, and will give you money." And we managed to get in 3 years' time later to many foreign clients who trust us and provide us money, and we provide them services, and we build something which people like it and use us many, many years. And we've been one of the few private institutions really build a relationship with the many big companies outside of Russia without any government support. And the same with the school. In business school, when I started, I said, I raised $500 million for the school, okay? I'm not sure. And I said I will be going and collegially will collect people, oligarchs, which will be naming, which is not right, but will give money to the project. They said, no way, because they're all egocentric. They cannot give money for the school if it's not their own name, okay? And I said, okay, I will try. And then we had a special bet with the Minister of Economic Development. He said, without government call, you will not get any one kopeck from anybody. And when I, $250 million equity, I raised $150 million debt. And $250 million equity was raised from people who just provide money just because they like the idea. And I think one of the key elements of this type of the being successful, and I say is that you need to have a vision, you need to have a consistency of delivering what you promise to deliver, you need to have values, and you need to have a very clear element of attracting best people to work for you. And this is the same about the doing in Dilijan school. When we said we will build international school, high school in Armenia, people said, what? In Armenia, high school with people. And we got now deputy head of Eton College moving to Armenia, become headmaster. And we're getting 50 countries of kids coming to study in Armenia in September. And we built this building, which a lot of non-Armenian people support, Russian, Swedish, German, Jewish, Muslim, Christian, and they support the project because they like the project, and we provide $85 million and raise money from the donors. And we put our own $100 million, but again, it's a $20 million project to build a school in Armenia, which people said it will be not possible to do it, it will be not right to do it, or it will be difficult to do it. It's a very difficult project. It's usually not easy to deliver what you're promising because it's a really tough environment and always not supporting, usually, this type of project because it's a too visionary, too long-term, and they're not reflected the current problems of Armenia or current problems of Russia. Having one question about education in Russia, I will say reform is going very slowly, and unfortunately, it's very inconsistent. One of the problems in Russia is a big country with a lot of inconsistency between many good attempts to do change. Because to do something is really makes long-term commitment. Like in SKOLKOVO, I started this project in 2005. I would say it will be successful or not in 2025, we'll know. Okay. In the Dilijan school, we started in 2006 with my wife. And we will open school in this year, and it will be 2023, and it will be full operation and full. Okay, that's why we're talking about very long-term visionary, which is in Russia and in Armenia, and emerging market usually is a very short-term oriented. And I think one of the two elements which I always said is will be critical for success is a trust and a long-term vision. And unfortunately, trust in one of the key problems in Russia and many other countries like emerging markets. who don't trust each other, don't trust institutions, don't trust government, don't trust business, and the cost of doing business much higher. Because when you don't trust, you need to spend more money for lawyers, for security, for any other element, just increase your safeness. It's just unfortunately creating more problems to make the business. Is the education reform in Russia going very difficult, very, very slowly and very controversial? Unfortunately, despite we can have unique kids, unique professors, unique institutions, but it's very, very fragmented, and we are facing big challenge for education, and the continued education transformation is under big question in Russia. And also, about the venture, the SKOLKOVO, what was the point? Like I said, it's 18 founding members, all business people. We're all coming, the diploma approval, we are getting and sitting listening what people, kids, students, I know, like, by the way, in business school students board, I don't believe the person who coming in business school is a student, because it's not a student, it's a young partner, young entrepreneurs, whatever, young manager, but he's not the student, he's not coming to pass exam, he's getting to get what he achieved something already in his life, he wants to get additional knowledge just to go next level. And we're trying to provide them first three things. We're providing access to the mentoring, because I believe education and mentoring are the key element of success, and especially in the business education, because mentoring is a key. You can get something that's not just reading in the books. This is why we're doing a lot of mentoring, and it's access to directly to us, and all the students getting access to the old business people, not only the founding members, but also others. Second, we're getting money. We get special funds we provide for startups, and we already have 18 companies started with the money with founding members provided. And we're providing infrastructure. We're providing legal, marketing, HR, all this other infrastructure support. This is why it's not the school, it's much, much broader, because it's the infrastructure which around the school we're trying to build, which will provide environment where you can get idea, people, money, and services. If you can do it, again, we're far from ideal. What I'm telling you, it's not happening today. This is what we're trying to build, but this is what was the vision and what we're trying to achieve.
Thank you. I think if you will have just a couple minutes left, could we collect one or two other questions?
Please.
First of all, thank you very much for your talk, Mr. Vardanyan. I'm Eric Aznavarian. I'm on a biotechnology program here at Columbia. What I see here, it's just my first year here, and I see that many venture capitalists are investing in the biotech field in the U.S., there are huge profit margins in this field as compared to others. So I was wondering, do you expect in nearest future that probably Russian investors, or maybe in Armenia, or yourself probably, will invest in this field and in science in general and biotech in particular?
Okay, let's collect one more question.
But it's all Armenian. I see how many Armenians in the room. Okay. Well, it's,
Mr. Vartanyan, thank you for coming. Hi, Gider Nersesyan, SIPA student. You mentioned about risk-taking in emerging markets, and you mentioned about leaving your $1,000 salary and going for $100 salary. My question is, how you are able to overcome fear of failure? Thank you.
I think it's a good question. I'm not sure I can answer in 1 minute, but the way was some, yeah? It's okay?
Your schedule is yours.
Oh, okay. Is it not limited? Because I think it's a very important question. It's... I'm looking back, and I was 20 years old boy, and I said, okay, what makes me so brave to move from the bank, which was already established, big, successful, and getting $1,000 a salary, which is really was dream, to go to a place with nothing, no guarantee, no future, and basically no without knowing what the future will be, and $100 salary, and why I did this. And I of course, now I can say, oh, I was... very smart, but there was many chances that the story will finish differently from how it finished now. But I think I will never regret about this, whether I made it, that whether it was successful or failing story, because key point for me was very simple. I had a dream, I had a system how I measure my success, and I had a very clear what I want to do, what I don't want to do. For example, I said myself, I want to build reputation, like being the best investment banker. And the bank, which was very famous bank, I don't want to mention name, was very, very famous, but I was feeling like it was very, will be good money-making machine, but it's not about reputation. Okay? This is why measurement of your success will be very key. Second, I said I can go long-term. My vision was 20 years, not about 1 year. So it was easy to take the risk, go down by salary, because it was my different time horizon. The third, I think, was very critical also. I said what I want to do, what I don't want to do in my life, building something which I believe will be successful. For example, I said myself, which I'm not, I hope you understand me correctly, I'm not trying to say it was good or bad ideas, but for me it was very important. I said, the day when I used to hire a bodyguard, I will resign from my position. And I never have a bodyguard for 20 years doing investment banking in Russia, which people who've been in Russia know how. But for it is for my criteria of success, okay? It's for other person, it doesn't matter, because it's I'm not saying if the life in Russia is dangerous, and maybe having bodyguard or doesn't have a bodyguard is not will save you. And it's more about different story, what why people do having bodyguard. But I'm just saying, it was very clear for myself what I want to do, what I don't want to do. We never been hostile takeover, for example. I've been investment bank and never hostile takeover. Not because it's bad, it's just my choice. And I say, okay, we didn't put Svejnar loan for shares. We didn't make some of the elements which was really profitable, which makes being an investment banker, I give up some of my profits because I want to be more comfortable. It's why I question about your risk taking. When where are you going for risk? I'm very risk taker? Yes, I risk taking. I took from $1,200 and went to the company, which basically is a no clear future with $35,000 capital. But at the same time, I didn't take risk from other elements. This is why when you think about risk taking, it's not every risk you need to take. The question again, what's your goal? What's your time horizon? What's your vision about what you want to achieve and how you want to measure your success? Because your success measurement can be different by numbers of money, what you have in your account, by being present in Columbia Business University and having the opportunity to speak with you, or something else. Okay, this is your choice. You need to be very clear about your choice. Not foolish yourself, not try to cheat yourself about, oh, I will do this a little bit because I want to do it later, something different. You need to be very consistent. I think one of the other ways of success is to be being consistent. And it's very difficult, especially in the emerging market. A lot of opportunities, a lot of different pressure you're getting, different things which press you to be more compromising yourself. As much as you're going to compromise, you'll pay the price. And I paid my own price also for being compromised sometimes.
Thank you very much. This was a terrific discussion. We're very grateful.
I wish all of you success and thank you for your interest in coming here. Thank you.